All right, we want to welcome everybody again and thank you for the privilege of your time and attention this morning. There's an outline for you to follow along. It's kind of our routine here. We are in the 6 of 7 parts on a series we call Transformed, How God Changes Us. And so we started out with spiritual health and then physical health and mental health, emotional health. You believe I preached a sermon on mental health? Woo. And last Sunday was relational health. Woo. Richard said I did a home run on that one. So he's coming back for more today. As we're going to talk about financial health. See, and they always accuse churches of talking about money all the time. Well, we're talking about it today. It's in the process. Next week, vocational health. So what about financial health? I look back and I say, didn't learn a lot from my parents about finances. Didn't learn anything in high school about finances. Didn't learn anything in college about finances. I didn't take Econ 1, did you? I did not. I didn't have to. And so I'm 22. I have my first job as a youth director. I'm making $700 a month. My rent for a two-bedroom is $125. How about that? Woo-hoo. I'm dating myself. And so I open a checking account. And after a few months, I cannot balance my own checking book. Mm-hmm. And I humbly go to my bank and I sit down with a nice lady who looks at my scratch and says, you know, let's not worry about that. Let's just start new right here. And let's just take the balance the bank has for you and start again. So that was my mess at 22. Right when I was getting married and so forth. Well, we went on, and I married a woman who understands finances much better than I do. Thank you much, dear. So, but financial health, the first bit of advice, good advice that I got when I was 28, just finished seminary, was from another pastor. I do not know who this person was. I just remember them saying, once you are ordained and a church hires you, start your retirement fund immediately. And you know what? We did. From the very first church on to the present day, 15% of my income salary has been taken out and put in the denominational retirement account. So that's really, really good for me. It is called, folks, the miracle of compound interest, right? And Albert Einstein knew about the miracle of compound interest. He called it the 8th wonder of the world. And if you understand it, you earn it. And if you don't understand it, guess what? You pay it, he says. This is something. And all that is early investment. You know, in other words, start your savings account as soon as you have kids for those kids, right? Over years of patience yields exponential payoff. So that's just a little thing I learned right away. Is there anybody here who will stand and shout out for us your first piece of financial health advice? Okay? Good advice. Anybody that got a piece of good advice, Karen?
Don't spend more than you earn.
Don't spend more than you earn. And we'll talk about that in a second. But thank you. That's good financial advice. Don't spend. Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Stay within your budget.
Live within your means. All of those things. So, well, let's define financial health. It is when one does not have to continuously worry about their ability to meet their financial obligations. One, as Dave Ramsey said, who lives and gives like no other. And yet, based on the statistics that I received online, the average American spends 1% more than they earn every month. In other words, they have more month than they have money. That their yearnings exceed their earnings. Is that you? Is that you? This message is for you. And I only have 20 minutes. If you're under financial stress because of that reality, we want to help you today. But I'm not going to give you anything particularly new or earth-shattering in terms of financial health. So I'm just going to strongly urge you right now, we have already got this on our 2020 calendar, is Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University. Have you heard of that? Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace. He's on the radio and so forth. He is anywhere in your town. Just go online and you will find a course in your town anywhere in the world. Ours is in January, and Dorothy is going to lead it for us. He's a Christian, well known for using biblical principles for financial management. And I would love to see our course filled with at least 50% of church people. Because typically in the last 3 years, we've had more people from the community in the course than we've had church people. And somehow that doesn't make sense. We're the host. And you need it as well, right? So come. And if you've taken it, take it again. Because every time, I've watched it 3 times. And we've invested in the material, right? And I learn something new, or am I reminded something every time I take it? Now you say, well, $130, I can't afford that. Well, here's my challenge, dear. If you cannot pay the $130, I will front you the $130, all right? But the condition is you must graduate 9 sessions. You cannot miss, and then I'll make good for it. At least one person, I can do that, right, dear? I can do that. So. All right. So I put it out there. I will front your $130 if you graduate in January. If that's a problem for you, come and talk to me. And I bet there's other people in the church who have completed the course and would do the same for you. So don't hesitate to ask if you can't really afford the $130. I don't think you can afford not to take the course. It will change your life. Enough commercials. All right, a couple things that I think you should know and do to improve your financial health. And you look on your outline. Number one, rid your mind and soul from the toxic and dangerous spirit of entitlement. You know that word? We live in a culture of entitlement. It is the lie that the government, the state, or some other institution owes me benefits for which I will pay nothing for. Those infected with this toxic attitude expect a living wage, housing, food, medical care, and other necessities of life, even though they will make no contribution in return for them. I do nothing and I get everything. This is this toxic spirit of entitlement. The Bible does speak in a couple of places about a group of Christians who are taking advantage of other believers. They are having this spirit of entitlement. And we find it in the book of 1 Thessalonians. Paul wrote it. He says to these Thessalonian Christians, "We urge you, brothers and sisters, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we have told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders and so that you will not be dependent upon anybody." So let me give you the context of this statement that Paul is writing. These are apparently relatively new Christians living in that town of Thessalonica, Mediterranean area around Greece and so forth. They had just converted from some type of paganism. Now they're Christians, new Christians. It's AD 51 thereabouts. And apparently due to their conversion to Christ, they have come under persecution and many of them have lost their jobs, their source of income, because they are Christians now. And so who do they turn to? Well, the other Christians who are employed. And so in the church, they're being welcomed, they're being fed and sheltered and all of that. And that's all fine and dandy. Christians ought to share with one another, Acts 2:42 and so forth. But this continued after a period of time. They were able to work, they were capable of working, but many of them were not working after a while. And this is because Paul's teaching about the imminent return of Christ. 5 times in his first letter, he talks about Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming back. Maranatha, you know. And because of this teaching, these new believers said, well, why should I get a job? Because next week, Christ may come back. Maybe next month, he'll come back. So why bother to get a job and just enjoy the hospitality of these other working Christians? And Christ is coming back, but he's not yet, even today. And so to correct this faulty behavior of idleness and dependency, in his second letter, he gives a third command this way. He says, "In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you." He's not messing around. "Brothers and sisters, Keep away from every believer who is idle and disruptive and does not live according to the teaching you received from us. For you know how you ought to follow our example. We were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's food without paying for it. In fact, on the contrary, we worked night and day, laboring and toiling, so that we would not be a burden to any of you. For even when we were with you, we gave you this rule: the one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. You've heard that, right? We hear that some of you are idle, some of you, and disruptive, that you're not busy, but you are busybodies. Such people we command and urge in the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down, even though Christ is coming, and earn the food you eat. So Paul is stating his own example. He says, me and my followers, when we were in your town and in your church, we did not take advantage of you. We worked, we paid for our own way and our own food. And so he says, this is the example. Yes, Christ is coming again, but get a job and start working. Settle down and earn the food that you eat. Now, you've heard the term the haves and the have-nots, right? I call them the rich and those who work for the rich. That's my phrase for them. There are two kinds of people, the rich and those who work for the rich, especially if you live in Santa Barbara, where a lot of my relatives live. But there was a family friend from Santa Barbara. I was with my father-in-law on his last hunting trip, and we were in the lodge, and this man was a manager of a tech company in Santa Barbara. We got to talking about employees and employment and hiring and disciplining those who aren't performing to standards. And he just says, you know, when there's an employee that is not living up to their expectations, I ask myself two questions, and here they are. Can and can't, will or won't. So the first question is, can they do the job or can't they do the job? And if they can, maybe I can train them so they do the job better. But that's the first question. Can they or can't they? Then the second question, if they can do the job but they're not doing the job, it's a question of attitude. Will they do the job or won't they do the job? And this is the question of attitude. And so he says, that's what I ask. Whenever an employee I have, I say, can they or can't they, or will they or won't they work? And he makes a decision accordingly. We can apply that same kind of question to the have-nots today. Can they work or can't they work? There are legitimate disabilities where people cannot be gainfully employed, and therefore, rightfully and legitimately so, they may become dependent upon taxpayers' support. And our society provides for that. There is disability income. But the greater question is, in this case, will they work? And if they are able and capable of working but won't work, that is a problem of attitude. And the Bible is going to confront that spirit. For those who are able but will not work, the Bible calls them sluggards. This is to be habitually lazy. This is to be slow moving, not alert, not hard working. The Bible says in Proverbs 21, 25, this is where you get most of these verses. The craving of a sluggard will be death to him because his hands refuse to work. See, it's an attitude. I refuse to work. I want other people to take care of me. Sluggards do not plow in season, so at harvest time, they look and nothing is there for them. Proverbs 6:6, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon the sluggard like a thief and scarcity like an armed man. So the Bible confronts such idleness. On the other hand, the Bible affirms the values of hard work and discipline, frugality, and generosity. This is called the Protestant work ethic, started by John Calvin. Proverbs 14:23, all hard work brings a profit. Proverbs 21:5, the plans of the diligent, or those who are disciplined, leads again to profit. And frugality, here is Jesus, right? Remember, when he fed the 5,000, and every time he fed masses of people, what was his next statement? Disciples, get some baskets and go pick up the leftovers. How about that? Jesus believed in leftovers, and we are in a culture where we are seeing this resurgence of recycle and repurpose and reuse, and we Christians ought to be on the top of that agenda. We ought to be the number one recyclers, repurposers, and reusers in our culture. This is a biblical value. And then generosity, of course, several verses about being generous. Ephesians 4, let him who steals steal no longer, but rather he must labor, performing with his own hands what is good. Why? So that he will have something to share with one who has need. So it's not just about working hard to meet your own needs. It's about working hard so that you have something to share with the less fortunate. Now, I'll be shameless and selfish here. One of the places your generosity is needed is in your local church, folks. And so I'm going to have a little family talk here in the middle of this service just to those who regularly attend and are members of the church. You folks, along with I am, I'm a member too. I voted to adopt a budget that is $25,000 a month to take care of this whole place and all of the ministries and staff and et cetera. But the first month after our new budget was passed, we fell short by $5,000. In August, we fell short by another $5,000. This month, September, we only fell short by $3,000. So I'm very encouraged that we went up to $22,000 in the offering last month. But then it was a five-Sunday month. So I don't know. And I'm hoping that this is a good trend all the way forward. So if you want to flip on to the backside, I don't do this often, but is your giving ladder. This is our giving ladder. And every church can probably produce such a thing. But just so you know, from Easter to the end of August, this is how the people who have been coming to our church support our church. And this is the levels that they support us. And I thank you very much if you're on the giving ladder. Somewhere you need to be on there if you're regularly attending our church. I implore you, if you are not on the giving ladder, to please, please pray and search your heart and ask God, what portion of my income can I start sharing with the church that is ministering to me spiritually? Jesus said, after all, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, it will be poured into your lap. You cannot outgive God. As you give to the church or to other needy people, God will see that you are repaid that in some way, some fashion down the road. God knows how, and you cannot outgive God. Any number of you can testify to that truth. As you give, God will restore what you have given to others. And so this is your first action toward financial health today. To avoid poverty and to improve your financial health, rid yourself of that spirit of entitlement and reclaim the biblical work ethic of hard work, discipline, frugality, and generosity. Point number one. Number two, the next biblical admonition is very simple. It's in Proverbs 22:7. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. I'm going to have a lot to say about that, but we are a culture. We are a people who love to borrow, and we become indebted to others. The total consumer debt, this is from the Federal Reserve's website, $3.8 trillion in debt us Americans are. Credit card debt, 41% of us are in credit card debt. 13% of us have student loans. $1.5 trillion in student loans are out there. 36% of us have auto loans for our cars and trucks. And 47% of our populations have a mortgage. And so we are a culture that is awash in debt. And so the action, the second financial health action is to get out of debt and to stay out of debt. That's the other thing. Stay out of debt, right? That's the hard part. And the way to do that is to take your credit cards and bring them to me right now. And this is how you will stay out of debt. You must cut up those credit cards. You must cut them up. You can't put them in the freezer. in a bowl of water, like I used to talk. You know, put your credit card in the bowl of water and freeze it, so then when you want to use it, you got to thaw it out first, you know? No, you'll do that. No, and in every Ramsey course, they have the scissor meeting, and where people cut up their credit cards. You really, that's really where it begins, people, and you have to cut up your cards. And then use the snowball method, right? You know what that is? You take the smallest debt you have, work everything, have garage sales, get a side job, whatever, and put all the money toward that small one. And then when you get that paid off, roll that same amount into the next one, and then roll that one over into the next one, and work your way up from the smallest debt to the largest debt. And this is the way you will get freedom. Freedom. Financial freedom. Financial peace. Financial health is to get out of debt and to stay out of debt. Won't say any more about that. Just to close here before we go into our Holy Communion time, is that money is an important topic to God. I haven't counted, but everybody who I know who counts Bible verses says that there are over 600 verses about money in the Bible. So it's a pretty important topic to God, and it is. Having money is not a sin. It's loving money that is the root of all evil. But it is a tool for good, or it can be a tool for bad. A friend of mine in the church here told me, have you watched on Netflix the program The Mind of Bill Gates? So my wife and I watched it the other night. You know who Bill Gates is, right? He's worth like $40 billion. And what he is doing with his money in third world countries in providing not just clean water, but sanitation is amazing. And he just put his mind to it and says, how can we solve that problem? And he's got the money to do it. And it's an inspiring story of how somebody is using his enormous wealth for enormous good in our world. And what is, I don't think he's a Christian, but still, he gets it, that his money isn't just for him, it's for the good of others. And so I ask you to look at that program just as a way of inspiring you. So here's a goal. For financial health, if you can live below your means and you can live on 80%, this is the 80, 10, and 10, save 10%, better to save 15%, and then give to God's work through your church 10%. The average American Christian gives 2.6%. So not everybody's tithing, you know? That's just the truth of it, okay? God knows, but this is the challenge, to live on 80, to save 10, and to give 10. And why should we give to God? We can't even see him. Well, the Bible says, Deuteronomy 8, remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. God is your supplier. God is your provider. God is your sustainer. Including your next breath is a gift from God. Your next heartbeat is a gift from God. Your next paycheck is a gift from God. Show that you recognize that, his sovereignty over you, by giving back to him in some way. Deuteronomy 14:23, giving to God teaches you always to put God first in your lives. This is how you honor God. This is how you communicate God. Are you first? Then I prove that by giving a portion of my income to you first off the top. And that shows that you're the number one priority in my life. Then, you know, God first, then family, then the church, and then other things. Your bills are last always. And I close with Matthew 6:33. Jesus says, seek first his kingdom, his righteousness, and all of these things which we need, food, clothing, and shelter, will be given to you as well. God knows how to take care of his people. If you will be faithful and you will offer to him what you have, he will do good things in return for you. So let's pray as we close. Lord Jesus, again, there's so much to be said about money management in the Bible. These are just two small things. You, again, convict us where we need to be convicted of, and you move us into those key choices to be financially healthy. So we thank you and praise you that you will guide us in that process. If we will begin to honor you with what you have given us, we have to start somewhere, sometime. Why not today? Lord, we want to respond to you, first of all, in saying thank you that you exist and that you love us. There is no person here or in anywhere in this world that is not the object of your love. You love us. And yet, the truth of the scripture is that our sins separate us from you, from having a relationship with you. But you, out of your love, sent Christ to forgive our sins by dying on the cross and taking our sins upon himself and satisfying the wrath of God against sin. And now, Lord, it is our choice to receive what God has done for us in repentance and in faith, accept Christ's forgiveness, and be restored in our relationship with you and begin to live under your rule and reign as a child of the King. Lord, if there's anyone here today who has trying to do this without your help, then it's a losing battle. You will not succeed in the transformation that is required. And so let the word penetrate our hearts today and help us respond in the name of Jesus. Amen.